Cheaper, faster, smarter. 2025 is being heralded by many tech experts as a year in which disruption from artificial intelligence begins to substantially impact the global economy. But while the US has been widely seen as leading and dominating the generative AI race, a surprise development has upset the AI apple cart.
It looks kind of like ChatGPT. And for the most part, it answers like ChatGPT, sometimes even better. But Chinese engineered DeepSeek was apparently made at a fraction of the cost of US chatbots and without the whiz-bang computer chips which have been critical for AI design.
This really goes to show that necessity is the mother of invention, as the old saying goes. Is they don't necessarily have the tens of billions of dollars that some of these companies in the US have.
When DeepSeek's open source model was released last month, it sent US tech stocks tumbling. Chipmaker Nvidia lost $1 trillion value in a day as DeepSeek became the number one downloaded app in the world. There are some notable limits to the chatbot. It won't say bad things about Chinese President Xi Jinping or answer questions about Tiananmen Square. Already, concerns over its operation and data access have seen DeepSeek banned from government devices in Australia. And for an American AI industry that thought it was way ahead of Chinese competition, DeepSeek is cause for a deep re-evaluation.
Sean Gourley is the former CEO of San Francisco-based Primer AI. He's back home at the moment and with us this morning. Kia ora, good morning.
Hey, good morning.
Great to see you. What is your assessment of the DeepSeek model and what it means for the AI contest?
Nice bit of engineering. First time we've seen a Chinese company really push the engineering. But it's important to kind of distinct between engineering to replicate a model more cheaply and engineering to create a new chip or engineering to create a new kind of architecture. They did the slightly easier piece of this is they made the system more efficient. And the truth is, for all of us playing in the space, there's a lot of efficiencies to be had. It's interesting that China made one of these jumps, but the efficiencies are everywhere. So there's been a lot of excitement in the market, but I think it's a lot of people haven't been following what's really going on in AI.
Right. So it's like improving the car rather than inventing a car from scratch.
They made the car more fuel efficient.
Right.
And that's significant, right? Because it means you can start putting more money in for less. You can get more returns for less money.
Mm. What does it mean for those assumptions that at the very least seem to underlie a lot of stock market activity that the US was well ahead of the Chinese when it comes to generative AI models?
Well, I don't think many of the analysts have even read the paper. So I think that the amount of understanding that the US financial market analysts have of actual AI transformer-based architecture and the efficiency gains and the rest of it is pretty small. So they're really trading on a kind of a highly leveraged bet that we think the US companies are going to win the AI arms race, but we're not really sure, and we could be sort of like scared away from that. So the market jumps. But the reality here is that what DeepSeek figured out was you can do a lot of the stuff that OpenAI was doing cheaper.
Mm.
But if you have the chips that OpenAI has, that means you can make these things smarter. And that means you go from a graduate level to a postgraduate level. And now most of us using these systems aren't going to be able to distinguish between a high school physics, a graduate physics, and a PhD physics. But those of us that are experts in those spaces look at this and say, wow, it got a lot better with more compute. So as you go up the compute scaling curve, these things get smarter and smarter.
Right. The US has had export controls on those most powerful chips that are absolutely critical, supposedly, to the AI race. What does this say about the effectiveness of those export controls? Have they had some perverse outcomes?
Yeah, so to be clear, DeepSeek was running this off of a very large number, estimates of tens of thousands, of quite advanced, and in cases, some cases, the most advanced NVIDIA chips. They were probably smuggled through maybe Malaysia, but these are the chips that were actually banned by the Biden administration under the CHIPS Act. So without these chips, they couldn't have done what they were doing. That being said, they have been working to try and get around these things by making the computations more efficient, which is what you do if you don't have the chips. So I think the sanctions are working, but China, because it realizes the importance of winning the AI arms race, is going to do everything in its power to make the calculations less dependent on raw compute power.
Mm, but so to that point, Is there a potential for perverse outcomes by putting export restrictions on those most powerful chips? From say, the US perspective, is it better to actually keep the exports in place, or has that enabled China or incentivized China to really drive innovation?
Or invade Taiwan, right? I mean, the idea is if you can't get access to artificial intelligence, you don't have the chips for it, you can't make a 3-nanometer fabrication and get a decent yield, well, you know what, a few hundred kilometers off the coast, yeah, there's the center of 90% of all the chips in the world, TSMC, Taiwan, this is the heart of the AI industry, and it's very much within China's sphere of influence, and it's got its eyes on it.
Yeah. Australia has banned DeepSeek from all government devices. We're seeing sort of similar responses around the world. The New Zealand government officials have been repeatedly warned to be wary about using it. Why should we see DeepSeek as any more of a security and data risk than any other generative AI model?
I mean, I think the idea here is, look, you don't go to war. The traditional axiom is you don't go to war if you don't control your energy supply chain, right? If you can't put, you know, gas in your tanks and gas in your planes, don't go to war. As war becomes increasingly AI-enabled, you don't go to war unless you control the supply chain of your compute and your artificial intelligence. So as you look at this from a Western versus Chinese kind of divide, you're going to see a balkanization of the technology stacks and the artificial intelligence stacks as well. So the first thing is you know, don't run your economy, don't run your war machine off the basis of a Chinese AI system. That would be a bad play. From an individual consumer, I mean, I guess it's up to you. Do you want to be told, you know, a politically censored view of the world, or do you want something that's a little more engaged in what really happened? You know, I'm going to choose the engaged one. Mm.
You were the CEO of Prima AI for, I think, about 8 years.
That's right.
The company counted the CIA's venture fund as an early investor. And in addition to your tech experience, you studied, of all things, the mathematics of conflict. So how do you think about AI in the context of modern warfare?
So I think it goes into the kind of framing of a technological offset. Now, technological offset basically says if you have a technology that is so capable it renders the opponent without the technology defeated before the war even starts. Mm. The first of these was nuclear weapons. The second was stealth weaponry and precision munitions. And the third is artificial intelligence. Now, what this means concretely is there's an arms race now to establish global AI dominance, because that means there's going to be global geopolitical dominance. Whoever gets this is very likely going to be running the strongest and most competent military in the world and will be able to project their ideology and power behind it.
Because theoretically, any opponent that didn't have AI dominance would rationally not want to enter a conflict with a party that did.
And they may try and they'd be very, very quickly defeated, right? So this is the arms race that's at play, and it's much more than, you know, do I have a ChatGPT to answer my homework? This is, do I have the right AI systems to run a swarm of massive drones to take down a carrier group inside of the South China Sea?
Right. At the moment, is AI being used on the battlefield?
We're seeing the very early stages of it inside of the Ukraine-Russia conflict. And so we're seeing things like loitering drones with computer vision systems. We're seeing some autonomous control systems for drones to be able to avoid electromagnetic warfare. But neither Russia nor Ukraine are AI superpowers. I've spent a bit of time with Ukrainian defense technology ministers. They're certainly engaged in bringing artificial intelligence in. And I think we'll see a lot more of it in the next 12 months if the war continues. But really, the action is between, between America
US
and China.
Yeah, right. So if over the next 12 months or so, we do see an increase of AI applications in the Ukrainian context, what would that look like?
Well, so the biggest thing at the moment has been drones. So if you look at, I think historians will look back at a Ukraine conflict from a technological perspective and say, this is the first war where drones played the leading role. Every person has a drone, every person has a drone they're controlling and a drone on them. Drones are now fighting drones in the air. And because drones are so effective, people are jamming the signal. So you've got these things, effectively, you know, virtual reality goggles, and you're driving these first-person shooters, literal shooters, through space.
Yeah.
Now, to defend against this, you jam the radio signals, and so the drone can no longer have that communication structure. So what we're going to see there is increasingly autonomous systems. At the moment, they're getting around this by dragging kilometers of fiber optic cable behind the drones so they can kind of keep operating them. But the much more effective way is autonomous systems. So you're going to get autonomous drones flying out that are impervious to the current defence measures. And that's going to be really, really interesting.
There must be huge ethical implications for this stuff.
Well, I mean, the ethical implication is if you're in a foxhole and you've got Russian troops surrounding you, what are you going to do? Mm. Are you going to use the system that gets you out alive, or are you going to use the system that say, I'm not going to touch this? And I think the reality is, as a realist in the nature of conflict, people are going to use what keeps them alive. And so we are going to see autonomous systems increasingly run inside of the Ukraine conflict, as we will around the world.
So that's the Ukraine context, but you say that the real battle for AI dominance, global AI dominance, is obviously between the US and China. What will winning that AI arms race mean?
Well, I think what we're going to see is you're going to move from human-driven systems to computer-driven systems. And so DARPA has been running a thing called Alpha Dogfight. If you've been following these systems, it's kind of like human versus machine, but for dogfighting.
Yeah.
And the machines are absolutely kicking the ass of the humans.
Yeah.
Like, it's not even close. They are faster, they are better, they'll take risks that humans won't take. Machines fly airplanes better than humans. The next step of that, and they're running this into kind of real trials at the moment, the next step of that is going to be swarms. Right. So instead of having one airplane, you're going to have 1,000, you're going to have 100,000. China's been putting on these amazing drone swarm demonstrations with dragons flying around, like fireworks.
Incredible.
Underneath that, if you're looking
context,
at that, you stick a small payload on that, you put a distributed algorithm that instead of being centrally controlled, it has autonomy, and now you say, we're going to put that at a major frigate. Well, the frigate's not going to stand a chance to defend against that because the systems weren't designed to take down 100,000 drones.
How far are we away from that kind of technology?
Within the decade.
Right. You warned the US Chamber of Commerce AI Commission in 2022 that there was a lack of close collaboration between defence and tech sectors in the US in contrast to China. Has that changed, and will it change under Donald Trump?
Yeah, so in 2016, when we started Primer, there was three of us, startups, companies serving US intelligence and defence. And the social licence to operate inside of Silicon Valley to build for defence just was very hard to come by. That's changed. And it changed, and we can always point to the day when Russia invaded Ukraine. Mm. When missiles were going through apartment buildings in Kiev, Silicon Valley suddenly woke up and said, well, rather than it being something we can't touch, it's something we must do. Mm. And the change was very, very rapid. So now you're seeing companies like Y Combinator funding low-cost cruise missile companies. You're seeing Silicon Valley realize that the values that they love and hold and cherish are not free. They have to be defended. And so you're leaning into that, and you're going to see a huge amount of scaling up of the relationship between DC and Silicon Valley for better and worse.
That's really interesting. So you're saying that before the Ukraine war began, the most recent iteration, not including the invasion of Crimea, but before that began, the social license was such so that in Silicon Valley, engineers effectively didn't want to work on any project that potentially had a defence application.
Yeah. So Project Maven, which was one of the first AI systems from the Department of Defence, we were partners on that. Google's employees walked out. Mm. They said, if you do this, we're not working for you.
Yeah.
Naive, right? Like, you're sitting there and saying, we're not going to work on defence. We love all the things it affords us, but we're not going to work on it. So it's ridiculous. So, there was a few of us standing there, and I think it's a very, very strong principle thing to say, look, you're going to work on the problem that matters the most. And as you look at the world as it's changing and moving, defense is incredibly important, and technology is increasingly deciding who has the geopolitical projection of power.
How should the potential impact of AI technologies impact the way that New Zealand thinks about defense, and in particular, Pillar 2 of AUKUS?
So, look, if we don't join Pillar 2, we've got to develop it ourselves. Likelihood of that happening, given the complexity, is almost zero. So if we don't join this, we're effectively the cavalry on horseback charging against tanks coming across the First World War in Europe. You're going to lose every single time. So New Zealand has a choice. Either we join that, we develop it, which is not going to happen, or we resign ourselves to effectively having no military force.
Why do we need it?
Why do we need a military force?
No. Why do we need that capability?
Well, because your opponents, if they have it, are going to destroy you within minutes.
Mm.
So we'll set our human, driven systems up, and the swarm will come at us, and away it goes. So the dynamic of this, if you don't have the technological edge, your weapons that you use to defend yourselves are going to be defeated by those that have it. And we're not going to develop this ourselves. Therefore, we're either going to effectively scuttle the military, or we're going to join AUKUS. But I think it's that simple.
Mm. If we step back and look at things with an even broader lens, over the next 12 to 24 months, how disruptive is AI going to be for the average New Zealander?
Well, I think, where most people are going to feel it is actually the kids in school. And the kids in school are going to be, did I do my homework? Yeah, no, ChatGPT did it for me. Mm. And everything that we teach inside of school at the moment can be done to a better level by a system that's going to cost you a few dollars in pocket change to produce the answers. Increasingly, that's going to be undergraduates in university as well. So if we kind of go forward 12 or 24 months, that's where most people are going to really experience it. The second thing they're going to experience is they're going to get given a task at work, and they're going to look sort of sideways and say, I'm just going to give it to the machine to do it. Mm-hmm. And they're not going to tell their boss, because they're going to be looking and saying, if the machine can do this, why am I working here? And so we're going to end this sort of weird sort of space where we all sort of know that the machines can do most of the things we're paid to do or are being put in school to do. But we don't really want to tell anyone, because we might kind of disrupt ourselves out of a job. So what you're really seeing in this is an unwinding of the knowledge work economy, which has driven so much of everyday lives of many, many New Zealanders, being very, very quickly replaced by machines that are more competent, cheaper, and don't go to sleep.
I realise that on a population basis, New Zealand is tiny in a global context. But are there things that we could be doing to ensure that New Zealand has more of an influence when it comes to the development of AI technology?
So I think that the major pieces on this are, look, you know, we've got to, you know, connect to Silicon Valley. We're actually culturally very close, time zone very close. We need to be connected to the centre of that. It all happens in Silicon Valley. You know, that's step number one. Step number two is we need to kind of go through and start to actually think about bringing AI into the defense companies that we've got in New Zealand. And the third bit there is we need to start reimagining what our economy is going to look like when AI can do most of the jobs we do today better than we can.
It's so good to speak. We could go for hours. Honestly, you've got to come back. Thank you so much.
Appreciate that.
We really appreciate it.